Yeah.
David.
Good evening, everybody. Welcome to Shakespeare and Company. The characters and episodes of Les Misérables are so embedded in world culture, so familiar from its many adaptations on stage and screen, that it's one of the few books one might feel legitimate claiming to know without ever having actually read. As I read David Bellos' The Novel of the Century, The Extraordinary Adventure of Les Misérables, however, I had two realisations. Firstly, that I didn't know the book at all. And secondly, that I really, really should. The Novel of the Century works on many different levels, from the macro, situating Hugo's great novel not only in French history, but also the history of publishing and printing technology, to the micro, when it details the many small quirks of the book, the hidden details that readers might otherwise pass over unawares. If you're already a devotee of Les Misérables, but want to know more about Hugo's political motivations, for example, The Novel of the Century is for you. If you're someone who likes to impress at dinner parties with trivia such as why Hugo chose 24601 as Jean Valjean's prison number, then The Novel of the Century is also for you. And for people like myself who have yet to tackle Les Misérables, The Novel of the Century is for you too. For not only does it function as a perfect argument for why Hugo's novel remains relevant, for why it should be read, but it also provides the keys to a deeper, richer and more satisfying read when you decide to take it on. David Bellos is director of the program in translation and intercultural communication at Princeton University and has won awards for his translations of works by Georges Perec, Romain Gary, Ismaël Kadare and Georges Simenon, among many others. He's also an accomplished biographer, having written lives of writers Perec and Gary, as well as filmmaker Jacques Tati. In addition to The Novel of the Century, he's also the author of Is That a Fish in Your Ear? A must-read for anybody with an interest in the art of translation. Please join me in welcoming him to Shakespeare and Company.
Thank you, Adam. It's a great pleasure, and I think quite moving for me to be here tonight, nearly 50 years from the time when I was first living in this area and trying to become a 19th century scholar all those years ago. I'm going to read a bit from the book that begins with Notre Dame de Paris, because we're right opposite, and then we'll have a conversation about it before asking you if you have any questions. So the part I'm going to read picks up the story in February 1861. Hugo is at Hauteville House in Guernsey, and he's right into the last stage of inventing part five of Les Misérables, many parts of which have been written before, but he's now really in the last stretch. So 30 years before then, in Notre Dame de Paris, which Hugo wrote in 1830-31, Hugo wrote a stunning description of medieval Paris as seen from the sky, Paris à vol d'oiseau, he called it. But now, 30 years on Guernsey, he sets about recreating the modern city of Paris seen from underneath. But it was a similar kind of imaginative enterprise, because Victor Hugo had never visited the sewers of Paris and drew all his information about them from printed sources that he had on his shelf. At the time he was writing, there were great works in train to enlarge and extend the underground network of tunnels and pipes, and Hugo knew perfectly well that that what he had to describe in his novel, which is set in the 1820s, was a system of urban intestines that had already been swallowed up and that no longer existed. However, the idea that the old sewers could have provided escape routes for wanted men and petty crooks was not a fanciful one. It really was true. People did use them that way. But what is on the brink of the impossible, of course, and what is purely fictional about Les Misérables, is that a 60-year-old man, Jean Valjean, could carry a well-built younger man, Marius, over his shoulder for several kilometres over alternately slippery and soggy ground, and even through a slough of shit that rises to his chin. This extraordinary feat brings Valjean close to figures from myth and legend. His escape from the destroyed barricade through the sewers is like one of the 12 labors of Hercules. It echoes the visit made by Theseus to the underworld. But it is also a Calvary, for the suffering hero bears a weight on his back as heavy as any cross. When, after hours of effort in the dark and foul air, he reaches an outlet to the light where the sewers go into the Seine, he finds a snarling guardian at the gate. The tollkeeper at the exit from hell turns out to be Thénardier, whose amazing ability to bob up again and again like a cork in the sea is equaled only by Valjean's repeated returns. The two men also share a frankly unbelievable immunity to the cholera bacillus, which would surely have killed anyone who spent that amount of time in the sewers of Paris in precisely June 1832. The first case of cholera was reported on the 26th of March of that year, and within a month nearly 2,000 Parisians had died of the disease. The epidemic raged on through the summer, carrying off not only poor folk living in hovels, but many eminent men and women too, among them Champollion, the decipherer of hieroglyphics, Sadi Carnot, the pioneer of thermodynamics, Casimir Perrier, the Prime Minister of France, and General Lamarck, whose funeral on the 5th of June 1832 had originally set off the insurrection from which Valjean and Marius are now escaping. Although nobody yet knew technically how the disease was transmitted, it was known or widely believed that cholera was connected to water supplies and to the disposal of human waste. So escaping with Marius on the 5th of June 1832 through the sewers was an even riskier undertaking than it seems in the novel. Now, book two of part five of Les Misérables begins, like book one, with a general essay. That some critics call digressions, but are really the heart of the book. And this one, in book two, is focused on the economic benefits of recycling human waste. Yes, indeed it is. Before the discovery of industrial methods for fixing nitrogen, and those discoveries made the end of the 19th, early 20th century, only natural fertilizers were available. And these ranged from animal manure to guano, which is sort of petrified bird shit, imported in large quantities from the Pacific and elsewhere. But in Paris and in many other major cities, night soil was also used, often reduced to pellets, and it was given various euphemistic names, but it was human waste in pellet form. However, Hugo had held long conversations on the foreshore of Jersey, where he'd been in exile in the early 1850s, with his neighbour there, Pierre Leroux, a utopian philosopher who was convinced that a more systematic reuse of human waste could bring higher agricultural yields and help to alleviate hunger among the poor. Leroux put a proposal for his system to the Parliament of Jersey. It was turned down, but he also ran a pilot plot in his own backyard, which was next door to the Hugo's at that time. So what Hugo proposes for Paris in Les Misérables was really no different from Leroux's famous scheme, but it was actually already out of date. There's a real engineering scheme for cleaning up the city and spreading fertilizer extracted from human waste in the market gardens of Gennevilliers, in the bend in the Seine to the west, was in course of construction already. But Hugo, of course, an enemy of the Third Empire, of the Second Empire, and of Napoleon III, could not acknowledge anything actually being done in Paris in the 1860s, and that has to be, as it were, left out of the story. Hugo's enthusiasm for recycling waste may seem slightly comical nowadays, but actually it's powered and grounded on beliefs of much greater import. Hugo wants us to hear him saying that nothing is so base as to have no use or place in the world, that the lowest may become the highest if treated the right way, and that Paris is not just a ship on a coat of arms or a collection of houses and prisons, but an organic whole, a living being, a breathing monster, a leviathan. Now, that escape scene, you know, through the belly of the beast, seems designed to be put on a cinema screen because, you know, fear of the dark, fear of getting lost, fear of drowning, fear of being shut in, you know, all these sort of nightmare buttons can be operated by a solo performer in a relatively inexpensive set, on stage or on screen. It's not especially difficult to show Valjean's victory over the obstacles in his path, or his moral triumph, which has a visible shape, which is the inert but still living body on his back, that belongs to a young man that Valjean has good reason to wish to see dead, because if Marius survives, he will steal from Valjean the object of his affection and care, his whole raison d'être. As he carries his heavy burden through stinking water that almost comes up to his eyes, Valjean turns from Hercules and Theseus into a Christ-like figure bearing his own cross. And the episode in the sewers seems to me makes Les Misérables something grander than a novel in the 19th century mode. It reaches out towards the creation of a legend and the transformation of a character into a myth. As the weather grew milder in February and March, and the days grew longer, Les Misérables emerged from under the ground. Marius, in the story, starts to recover, and the author, who'd been quite unwell earlier that year, also seemed to be getting better. Hugo's physician, Dr. Corbin, thought that his illustrious patient would benefit from a break in his arduous work. And he mentioned to Juliette, Hugo's mistress, that Victor was actually fit to travel. And the idea of a trip occurred to Adèle, Hugo's wife, as well. And for once, both wives were of one mind, that a holiday would be good for them all. Even more surprisingly, Victor Hugo agreed. He hadn't been off the islands for 9 years, and he felt that he would like to get away from these very small places for a while. What he didn't tell anyone yet was the real reason for his wish to go. A new dock at St. Peterport had just been finished, and paddle steamers now linked Guernsey to Weymouth, Southampton and Cherbourg on regular schedules. New railways connected the ports to London and Paris. Travel had never been easier. However, there were no passenger cabins on the Aquila and Cygnus, the two steamers that plied the Weymouth and Southampton routes, and travellers had to sit or stand on the open deck for 8 to 10 hours. Depending on the weather, which is very variable in this part of the world, passengers would get sprinkled with sea spray, soaked by a breaking wave, or drenched by pelting rain. And damp is no greater friend to ink and paper than is fire, so great precautions had to be taken by a writer with a manuscript in his bags. For the ream and a half of blue-tinted blank paper and the 1,000-odd sheets of what was already written, Hugo had a custom leather case made, which was then treated by a brand-new special process to make it waterproof. And it worked. Not a page of Les Misérables got smudged. As she was able to enter France in a way that Hugo was not, Adèle, his wife, left first on a two-hour crossing to Cherbourg. And 2 days later, on the 25th of March, Hugo, Juliette and his son Charles boarded the Cygnus for Weymouth. Victor Hugo also had a daughter called Adèle, and which is constantly getting confused with his wife called Adèle. So daughter Adèle and her aunt Julie stayed on at Hauteville House to look after the dogs. The crossing was calm. Hugo stopped briefly in London, called on another doctor who also said he was fit to travel, and then went on by way of Dover and Ostend to Brussels, where they joined up with Adèle, who had got there by rail overland from Cherbourg. The weather was mild, Hugo's spirits were high, he scoured antique shops, old friends came from Paris to see him, he went on excursions, held meetings, but he didn't forget what he'd really come to do. "Finishing my book would please me more than all the excursions in the world," he wrote to his son, François Victor. And indeed, the holiday came to an end on the 7th of May. Leaving Adèle in Brussels, Hugo and Juliette took up residence at the Hôtel des Colonnes in Mont-Saint-Jean, a village 15 miles to the south of Brussels, with a bedroom window looking directly onto the site of the Battle of Waterloo. For the following 8 weeks, Hugo wrote in his hotel room every day. For exercise, he tramped through the countryside, seeking and finding traces of the huge battle that had taken place there. But the landscape wasn't the same as it had been in June 1815. Hugo's room faced the Lion of Waterloo, which is a monumental sculpture atop a huge conical mound. 300,000 cubic metres of earth had been excavated to make this, which was Europe's first purpose-built war memorial, and had changed the lie of the land completely. And that was the reason that Hugo had come here. He had come, in fact, to do the fieldwork to allow him to imagine what had really happened at the Battle of Waterloo, and which he writes about in that famous chapter much earlier in the novel, but as yet unimagined and unwritten. During these long days of writing and walking, Juliette had Victor to herself, which happened very rarely these days. Hugo had inserted himself into Les Misérables in many ways already, and so it must by now have seemed natural to use the last grand scene of the book as a homage and gift to the companion of his life. He has Marius and Cosette marry on the 16th of February, 1833, and that is the night that Hugo and Juliette first spent together when they fell madly in love in the theatre. It's a touching way to say thank you to a woman who had devoted her life to serving him, but the gift was even sweeter than that. The wedding of Marius and Cosette in the novel falls on a Shrove Tuesday. And if you have read the novel, you remember that's an important little plot link, because the wedding procession gets tangled up with the Mardi Gras parade, which allows Thénardier to see what's going on and to cook up another plot, which is one of the final plots in the novel. However, February the 16th, 1833, was not Shrove Tuesday. In fact, it wasn't a Tuesday at all. It was a Saturday. Had Hugo forgotten what day of the week it was when he fell head over heels in love? Certainly not. What he'd also not forgotten was that Mardi Gras was Juliette Drouet's favourite day of the year. And it seems to me that running those two days together, the actual date and the celebratory date, in defiance of the mere calendar, makes it quite certain that Hugo intended to inscribe Juliette twice over in the happy ending of his greatest work in prose. Hugo's use of dates started a real trend. James Joyce's Ulysses is set on the 16th of June 1904 to commemorate the writer's first night with Nora Barnacle. Georges Perec set the entire action of La Vie Mode d'Emploi, Life a User's Manual, around 8 p.m. on the 23rd of June 1975, because that's when his companion Catherine Binet turned up in a restaurant for their first dinner date. These classics of modernist and postmodernist fiction owe more than you might think to the allegedly old-fashioned Misérables.
Thank you so much. And that was I think a really representative passage of the book, because we have the grand scope of history, and we also have the little details that that I mentioned. In that extract, you mentioned Georges Perec, who has been one of your focuses in your career. And I mentioned in my introduction Perec, Romain Gary, Jacques Tati, all of whom are great figures of 20th century French culture. What made you, after spending so much time in the mid 20th century, what made you want to visit Hugo in the 19th?
Well, you may not believe this, but I'm very, very old, and I began as a 19th century scholar. Mm-hmm. Is this working, this thing?
I think so, yeah.
It is.
Yeah.
Okay. I began as a 19th century scholar, and having written those three books that you mentioned, Perec, Tati, Gary, all of whose oeuvre are all sort of located around the 1950s, 1960s, I just felt like going back to my own origins as a 19th century scholar, and to a book that I'd always, well, as I say, I didn't read till quite late on, and had always sort of skirted around and never quite got to grips with. So that's how that happened. But I have written books about Balzac and other aspects of 19th century, and I have never stopped being a teacher of 19th century French literature.
And the process of researching a book, because one thing that becomes immediately clear when reading the novel of the century is how meticulously researched it is. Are there challenges that you face while researching someone like Hugo compared to researching these more modern figures?
Oh, yes, it's quite different. Hugo has been... I mean, you know, the number of books, of scholarly books about Hugo fills shelves, more shelves than you can see here. I mean, there's a huge amount of writing about him in French, in English, in other languages. The primary research has been done, and much of it has been done very well. So that my task really was to try and absorb that primary research and to use it to tell a story that makes Les Misérables accessible and puts it forward in a way that is accessible today. With the work on Perec, of course, was research of a quite different kind. It was a heroic fate. Nobody knew anything about Perec. There was nothing about Perec. And my task was to go and meet people and look things up and find documents and so forth. With Hugo, that's not necessary. Pretty much everything that exists has been published and it's on the library shelves. And I must say, a lot of it is terribly boring until, you know, it really is hard work. I mean, it's, and you know, a lot of it's in the 1950s and 60s on paper that is now falling to pieces, you know, smelly and dusty. And, but there you are. It was more that sort of research than any kind of action research. But I did go and look at some of the plot. I wanted to see Digne. I wanted to see Montreuil-sur-Mer. And, you know, there are things people just don't notice. I don't know why, but I got off the train at Montreuil-sur-Mer and started walking around and having a look and discovered that there is a hamlet just outside the gates of the town called La Madeleine sous Montreuil. So there are approximately that number of books of speculations as to why Monsieur Madeleine is called Monsieur Madeleine, and you get to Montreuil. It's obvious why he's called Monsieur. On his arrival at Montreuil, he passed through La Madeleine sous Montreuil, and obviously gives the idea for a pseudonym to adopt to transform yourself. So little bits like that turned up, and obviously I also went to Guernsey, which I love. It's a lovely place and I thoroughly recommend it, out of season. You know, to look at the house where it was written and to see it's been preserved, it's pretty much as Hugo left it. And so you can be up there in the room where Les Misérables was actually written and see what it was that and you know, it is amazing to think that he was there in this beautiful house, in this beautiful island, looking out at the shore, the port, the sea, the rocks, the island of Sark, and then looking down and describing the sewers of Paris. The dissonance between his environment and his imagination is really quite... I mean, I can't think of a better example of what it means to have an imagination, to be entirely unaffected by what you can see.
I'd just like to do a quick straw poll. Can you just raise your hands if you've actually read the unabridged Les Misérables cover to cover? Okay.
Okay, well, there's still a market. Yes.
How many people have seen an adaptation or another of it, whether on stage or screen?
Yes, okay.
Okay, and this is what I was curious because, as I said, like I haven't read Les Misérables, and yet I feel I know the story. I've seen it on stage. I've seen one or two adaptations of it. And indeed, you said it actually, despite the fact you were a specialist in 19th century French literature, you actually came to it rather late.
Yes, I did. Yes. I can't remember exactly how it was, but I was 30-something and already allegedly a teacher of 19th century French literature. At least I was paid to do that. For some reason, I got persuaded that it would be a good idea to go on a hiking trip across the Alps from a place called Servoz. And I thought, I can't imagine what I'm going to do without having a book to read. But, you know, there's a real disadvantage in weight, you know, so I wasn't going to take something. So I needed something light, but with a very high a content-to-weight ratio. So a Pléiade edition, you know, with on the print on that Bible paper of Les Misérables that had been on my shelf for ages and I'd never read. It seemed to me to have the requisite qualities of an infinite amount of reading for not very many kilograms. And the walking trip was pretty grim. I didn't really like it. And it started raining and then even snowing and I caught a cold and so I'm going to give this up. So we trudged down the mountain and found a hotel and I went to bed. And I started reading Les Misérables and I was absolutely entranced. I mean, I really was completely taken by a book of such ambition and scope and yet so tightly wound together. So I kept my cold for several days longer than strictly necessary so as to get right. And I read it all the way through. I can't remember how many days, but anyway, I read it all the way through in those rather special circumstances when I was on holiday. And then I did nothing with it for decades. Mm-hmm. And I came back to it, I don't know, about 5-7 years ago. Mm-hmm. I thought, this is really something that needs doing.
Mm-hmm. And why do you think it took you so long to read it in the first place? Was there... because most people would probably cite it as one of the essential pieces of French 19th century literature, and yet, for some reason, and for most of us here as well, it's been...
Well, no, I think it's not mysterious at all. Les Misérables is not often set on academic syllabuses simply because it is so long and nobody expects students to be able to get through it and you know, in a semester or and there is there has always been a desire to make academic syllabuses you know, a bit more like salads, where you have a little bit of this, a little bit of that. So you tend to set short books, and the really big books, well, only if you have a whole course on Les Misérables, and that's rather daring, and not many academics dare devote an entire semester to just one book, you know, because it feels like shortchanging people. So that's one reason why at university level it's not taught. But a second reason, I'm sure, was that, you know, when I was a student and for many decades after, there is a kind of snobbery about books that are popular. I mean, after all, the great contribution of 19th century French literature to world culture is Dumas, The Three Musketeers, Les Misérables, Jules Verne. These are the books that really do form a kind of global popular culture that is shared between youngsters, whether they're in Shanghai or in Santiago. And there is a kind of sniffiness that, you know, books that are that popular can't really be very interesting. And, you know, that's wrong. They are really interesting. And the way a work of art, be it literary or other, can get, like, into the bloodstream of global culture, like you say, so that you have the feeling that you know the book even when you haven't read it, I think that is a really interesting phenomenon. Those works have got something that other books haven't got. You know, it's not true of Madame Bovary. You know, Madame Bovary is much more widely read because it's on syllabuses, it's teachable, but it isn't part of a kind of a global popular culture in the way that Les Misérables or Monte Cristo or Captain Nemo actually is. And I think more attention should be paid to the extraordinary contribution that 19th century France has made to 21st century popular culture, including fan fiction, in which Les Misérables ranks number 13 as a vehicle for fan fiction. It's an amazing achievement. It does mean that these works speak to a very wide public. But I think there's a degree of snobbery in saying, well, if they do that, then they don't need us to read them as well. I think that's not true.
You mentioned the fan fiction, and one of the things I very much appreciated about this book was that you don't feel the need to limit your study of the phenomenon to the novel itself. I mean, obviously the novel is the source of most of your inspiration, but you do talk about fan fiction. You do talk about some of the anomalies of adaptation. So I think of the common misunderstanding that Jean Valjean was a galley slave, which, well, maybe you would like to...
Well, that's me being pernickety and professorial. There's a word that's been misunderstood in English and that has produced a different Jean Valjean for the screen, and that's going. Yes, I am interested. I mean, my book is about how Les Misérables became what it is. It's about how it was written, but also about how it's been read and used and reused. I can't quite separate them out, and I certainly want to tell those two stories as best I can together. Part of the reason for my wish to do that is that Hugo's wish also in writing the book was for it to be a multimedia event from the start. He commissioned his own son Charles to write the theatrical adaptation, and it was due to go on stage in September 1862, that's to say 6 weeks after the appearance of the last volume of the novel. It didn't, in fact, and it's not a very good adaptation, and it was a complete lead balloon when it finally got aloft in Brussels in the spring of 1863. But because it was also printed, it's been the model for subsequent stage adaptations because it's available as a print version, unlike any of the others. Les Misérables was on stage in bits in Italy even before the full text of the novel had appeared. It was on stage in one adaptation or another of one part of, or another of it in the UK every year from 1863 to the end of the century under a whole range of titles, performed in London and Birmingham, Manchester, in Sydney, in California, all over the place. And indeed in Britain, I think it has had more impact, a bit like the novels of Charles Dickens, it had more impact through speech and stage than it did through the actual printed book. In America, it's different. In America, it was immensely influential as a serial novel, you know, in printed in, you know, sort of a 50-page fascicule, that were the favourite reading, the really favourite reading of the Confederate troops in the American Civil War, who didn't really mispronounce it, but they called it Les Miserables. Well, that's sort of southern accent, Les Miserables. And then they thought that's what they were. And that became the name of the southern army, Les Miserables, the miserable soldiers of Robert E. Lee. And that's really stuck in American culture. And if you read Gone with the Wind, you'll see that's what they're reading in Gone with the Wind, if you read the novel. Yeah? If you see the movie, it's been replaced by David Copperfield. There may be a whole political story about the timing and so forth. So it seems to me that Les Misérables as it is a novel, of course it's a novel, but it's also a novel, it's a myth, it's a poem, and it projects itself towards stage and opera from the start and from Hugo's own impulsion. So that's why I think you have to tell the story of its becoming and as well.
And indeed, you entitled your book The Novel of the Century. And one of the things I found fascinating reading it was not only the insight it gave us into the book, but also the insight it gave us into 19th century France generally, and how the book at certain times, how Les Misérables was at certain times conforming with the way things were done in 19th century, in the sense that it was a life story novel, for example. But then in other context, it was sort of exceptional for various reasons, like, for example, the contract that Hugo signed.
Yes. Well, the novel of the century, you know, you're allowed to do this with titles, to be thoroughly ambiguous. It's the novel of the century in purely sort of hype terms, publishing terms, in that it remains the most expensive literary work ever published. Hugo got an advance of around £3 million for an 8-year license. And I don't believe any literary work has ever been sold for more than that for such a short license. So it's, you know, the deal of the century in that sense. And that's a nice piece of hype. But it is actually rather remarkable. I mean, here is this exile with no right to reside in France on this little island in the middle of the Channel, actually negotiating the biggest contract. Is enough to build a small railway. Anyway, kept in 97.3 kilograms of gold. So it's the novel of the century in that sense. But it's the novel of the century in a quite different sense. Hugo's aim in writing the novel is to describe his own century, is to identify and get us to understand, you know, what is wrong and what needs to be done, and to understand what is the 19th century as opposed to the past. And of course, it begins in 1815, and that's really significant. For France, the 19th century begins in 1815, begins with Waterloo. But I also wanted to play on the ambiguity of the novel of the century, because I don't say which century in that title, and I think it's a novel for the 21st century too. And I think we're sort of not a little in need of the meanings of Les Misérables now, which is a book that doesn't actually have a political program other than a very general support of universal suffrage, but it has a moral program of reconciliation, respect for the poor, reduction in the division, in the social divisions between the classes. It is a novel of immense generosity, and I think that we could do with it right now, and it's still just as powerful as it was then.
And indeed, in the book, you say that it was equally, during the 20th century, equally respected in the United States as in the Soviet Union, which is interesting because it implies that perhaps at a time when political ideology was so important and so dominant, that the sort of the interpretations of it could be so wide ranging.
It is rather extraordinary that it managed to, or Hugo, I suppose, because of the political positions he took up after 1870, became very much persona grata under the Soviet cultural regime, and was the author, the French author, promoted and regarded as a model of writing. Les Misérables was very, very widely read, and it was translated, as far as I can tell, quite faithfully, and I've had various parts of it checked. And even where, Hugo in Les Misérables says, the bourgeoisie does not exist. Yeah? Hugo does not believe in class warfare, and he does not believe that you can divide society like that. Well, that's sort of pretty dreadful thing to say in sort of 1936 Moscow, but it was not cut. The old Soviet editions keep all of Hugo's scepticism about ideas that he'd vaguely heard of from Marx and things. And yes, it's quite amazing that a novel that seems to praise young men with crazy ideas who get themselves shot could be quite so popular on Broadway. In America, even under the 1987, it was still the Cold War, and there you have the white-haired ladies with the husbands coming out of a very expensive show on Broadway and humming revolutionary tunes. It's really very interesting that the material, the sentimental material of the work, allows a basic message of hope and optimism to be transmitted in this way, even through all these rewritings and transformations on stage, virtually irrespective of the political ideology of the spectators.
And you mentioned the sort of the Russian translation, and this is an interesting point in itself, the language of Les Misérables. And as I said in the introduction, so you have this macro view where you talk about the 19th century and French history and French culture, but also one of the reasons I think actually that I'm quite glad I haven't read Les Misérables yet is that I think in reading the novel of the century, it helps enrich the reading that one will make of it. So, for example, on the subject of language, you go into a lot of detail about the type of slang that Hugo employed, or the way the names were generated, which, with as a general reader without having read this, I might not have given much thought to.
Well, I hope it does enrich the reading. Some people might say it's really very boring and I'm being very nerdy, but I mean Hugo goes on a lot about language in one part of Les Misérables, and I give an account of what it is that he says about the social stratification of French language, and I don't go on too long about it, but I do give some examples and try and make sort of a broad sense of it for people who aren't particularly interested in French as such. But yes, there's a fair bit of detail about the language. And I mean, the thing is, Les Misérables is difficult to read in French as well. You don't grumble about reading it in English. There are loads of words in the original, in Les Misérables, that no French person beyond real 19th century specialists can be expected to know, or is likely to know. And there are a number of mysterious words in Les Misérables of which nobody really knows the meaning. And if you look them up in the Trésor de la Langue Française, which includes Les Misérables as part of its database, what you find is an explanation of the meaning of that word based entirely on its occurrence in Les Misérables, because it doesn't appear anywhere else. And I have a sneaking suspicion that some of those words were actually invented by Victor Hugo, because I would not put that past him. He was a great master of bending the language, and every now and again he threw in a few things just for fun. So reading it in French, do not be surprised if you come across words you don't know. Do not feel guilty or inadequate, but have a look and see what Christine Donaher, the latest translator of Les Misérables, managed to do with it, and then add a dash of salt.
Although, interestingly, her translation, when I believe it's been changed now, but when it was first published, was published not as Les Misérables, but as The Wretched.
Yes.
And, of course, one of the quite exceptional things about Les Misérables, at least in English, is that it keeps its original yes. French title,
yeah,
for the most part.
Yes, it's a fascinating story. The original American translation by Charles Wilbur did have a series title at the top, The Wretched. Yeah? Mm. And then underneath that, each volume is called Fantine Cosette. So it's The Wretched, Fantine, under that, in brackets, Les Misérables. Mm. But everybody picked they picked Les Misérables rather than The Wretched as its title. Mm. Wretched is probably the only possible translation of that word into English, but it's so much weaker than what Hugo does with it in the novel. What I try to explain in the book is the different layers of meaning, because misérable means many things in French. But I think that what Hugo had in his mind when he used it was actually the Latin word miserabilis, those to be pitied. Mm-hmm. And there is a wonderful sentence slap bang in the middle of the novel, in the virtually the middle page, where he says that actually, the wretched in the sense of the despicable, yeah, wretches, and the wretched in the sense of the oppressed, the poor, the downtrodden. In the end, there's no difference between them, and they are all lumped together under this fatal word, misérable. And you can see he virtually changes the word meaning of the word misérable in so doing in that sentence. And I think that's why the name Misérable has to be the name of the novel. But it is its name in French, in English, and in Japanese, where it's called Re Miserable. Mm-hmm. It's just transliterated into a Japanese sound system. But in other languages, it's translated semantically. Mm-hmm. But you can see how weak that is. In German, it's Die Elenden, which means the suffering ones. Yeah? In Hungarian, it's Nyomoroltak, which just means poor people. I mean, that's a short of cash people, poor in that sense. In Russian, it's Otvorzhene, which means the outcast, the excluded. And Mizab means all of that. It means poor people, and it means suffering ones, and it means outcast. And it really just... So that's... Keeping it in French and English, I agree, it's quite rare, but it's quite interesting to make a list of those works which are known in English under their foreign titles. And they're mostly religious works, like the Popol Vuh, or national epics, the Kalevala. The Dolce Vita doesn't really count, because the phrase Dolce Vita is already a phrase of English before the movie. But it's a peculiar list, the list of those works known by foreign... Somebody ought to write a thesis about that.
One of your graduate students.
Yeah, I think they're quite good at it.
Now, I could go on all night, but I'm sure there are going to be plenty of questions in the audience for you. So if you would like to ask David a question, just raise your hand. We'll get a microphone to you so everyone can hear, and then we'll get going. Let's one at the back there.
Yeah. Thank you very much. You told us that Victor Hugo influenced one of my favorite writers, James Joyce. Can you tell us in what way he did so?
I have no idea whether he influenced him, but James Joyce did the same thing as Victor Hugo did in using a sentimental date in his own life as a literary event. Ulysses is set on the 16th of June 1904, which is Bloom's Day, and which is the actual day when James Joyce first spent a night with Nora Barnacle, who became his wife, which is exactly the same thing that Hugo does in Les Misérables, by setting the fictional wedding of Marius and Cosette on the actual date when he fell in love with Juliette Rouet. That's the connection.
Language.
Oh, there may be many other connections, but that's the numerical one I was pointing out as a kind of a tradition that seems to begin with Les Misérables and that has been relayed by Joyce and by Perec, and no doubt by many others too. It's become a kind of a motif to do that.
On the subject of those connections, could you, with the other people, so we mentioned Perec and Gary and Jacques Tati, do you see any sort of lineage that, apart from their nationality, that connects Hugo to your other centres of interest?
I really it never occurred to me that there might be a connection between Victor Hugo and Jacques Tati. No, the Tati episode is something complete. I was really interested in writing a book or getting to understand somebody who was just not verbal. Mm-hmm. You know, somebody completely different from me. I mean, Tati would have been nothing if he hadn't had the cinema. Mm-hmm. Yeah. There is a strong connection between Hugo Les Misérables and Romain Gary. Mm-hmm. It is possible to read quite a lot of Robert Garry's writing, and especially his writing as Émile Ajar, as a distant rewriting of Les Misérables, yeah? Or at least of part of Les Misérables. Romain Gary is a sort of self-invented Gavroche, is quite a powerful reading of La Vie devant soi. Mm-hmm. The relationship of Perec and his whole group of the Oulipo with the great 19th century novelists from Balzac to Proust is very contentious, very stressed. They're supposed to not like them at all, but I think they borrow more from them than they say.
Okay, any more questions? Yeah, just Dan.
How long is the novel, and how long did it take him to write it?
633,000 words. No, I do know, because it's up on the web, and it's on I can do a word count. I have done a word count on a PDF file, so I haven't done it by hand. It took him 17 years to write it, but not. But the part of the point of my book is it is so long, and it is what it is because it was written twice. He started writing in 1845, when Hugo was in the prime of life. He was a man in his 40s, a peer of the realm, member of parliament. And he got to the point in the story where a revolution breaks out, and he's describing the barricade when a revolution breaks out. And he has to stop writing. He very nearly loses the manuscript when his house is ransacked by rioters. And his life is completely transformed and changed. Between 1848 and 1852, Hugo goes from being a grandee to being an exile, a man chased abroad. And it took him a long time to get back to it. So he comes back to it in 1860. And then it goes fast. Then he really goes fast. And he expands it from about 200,000 words to 600,000 words in a little more than a year. And then it's another year before it actually appears as a printed book. So it appears in 1862.
Yeah. Wow.
Okay. So, but I mean, it said all of it was already worked out in his head. I mean, you know, it was coming back to something that had been invented long before and had been maturing in his head since then.
Just in his head, or with notes and plans and...
There seems to be almost no work. There are a few little scraps, but almost no work on it between the 22nd of February 1848, when he just had to stop, and 1859, when he starts fiddling around with it again and actually starts writing it on Christmas Day of that year, and then writes all the way through 1860 into the spring of 1860, ending on the bit I read on the battlefield of Waterloo, where he actually writes the last lines, the epitaph of Jean Valjean, in June 1861.
So it was mostly written in Guernsey, was it?
Yes, by far the largest part of it was written in Guernsey, yeah.
And if I remember rightly, when he between those two writing best, when he started again, he made a sort of almost comically short list of the changes he was going to make, which then went on to add an extra 400,000 words.
Yeah, yep. It's just a little list of 19 points, you know, things to do, you know, like a sort of a 19th century post-it memo to self, and they seem peculiarly trivial. But, you know, it's just a prompt to getting started again, getting firing up the engines again. Yeah, that's right.
There's a question right at the back there.
Could you talk a bit more about why he wrote this book? It sounds like making money and creating a spectacle were two goals, but personally and sort of, I guess, politically and artistically, what goals did he have in writing this particular work?
Thank you for asking that question. No, I don't think making money was an aim in writing the book. It was a consequence of writing the book. When once he'd written it, he knew he'd written something very valuable. Making a spectacle also, I think, grows out of the book that he'd written rather than being an initial aim. He was already an enormously successful playwright. And if he just wanted to write a play, he would have written a play. The origins of the book lie in, I think, Hugo's changing sensibility in 1845, when he was, because of his eminence as a man of letters, appointed, he was given a life peerage. He was appointed to the upper house of the French Parliament and as a gift of the king. But he could see all sorts of things around him that weren't right. And in his notebooks and diaries, you know, there are lots of little observations of scenes of poverty and humiliation and of things he's worried about, civil strife. And his maiden speech in the Chambre des Pères was on la misère. And it's a great thing to read. Apparently, he wasn't a very great orator. I mean, in actual voice, he didn't sound as thundering as it sounds on the page. So it's probably better to read it. But he wasn't a great economic theorist either. But he, like Charles Dickens on the other side of the channel, wanted to alert people to the fact that something had to be done about the mass of paupers all around in Paris. And he started writing a poem. Ended up in Les Contemplations, a poem called Mélancolie, but he probably wrote the first draft of that around the same time, because it's on the back of an envelope addressed to him at the Chambre des Pères, which means it must be around April, or after April 1845. And I think that the idea of writing about a convict who makes himself into something on his release, and the idea of writing about a woman forced into prostitution through poverty, were, to begin with, indistinctly the subject of a plan of a possible novel and of a possible poem. And some of it went into a poem, but then it took off as a prose work. He did have this overhanging contract with his publisher to write a second novel. Yeah, Notre-Dame de Paris, that appeared in 1831, this huge bestseller, was done under contract for that novel and another one. And so he always had this awkward thing hanging over him that his next novel belonged to that publisher already, and he would have to buy him out or something if he ever wanted to publish it properly. So that's probably why he kept putting off writing his second novel, because and did all sorts of other things. So no, I think the mid-1840s are a moment of kind of moral sensitivity to the issue of poverty, and that's what started this whole thing going.
Any more questions? Yeah, just the lady just there.
Hello. I was wondering, considering that Great Expectation was almost published the same year, and both novels have prominent characters of convicts, was there any relationship between both writers?
Ah, I wish. It is extraordinary. It's one of these extraordinary facts of literary history that Dickens finished Great Expectation, or the writing of Great Expectations, about 4 weeks before Victor Hugo finished the writing of Les Misérables. May and June 1861, respectively. There's quite a lot about Dickens, but I found that working on Les Misérables, I had to reread Dickens. And Dickens and Hugo, in this respect, really, it's bizarre. They're on parallel paths. They're observing the same kinds of societies, and they're having similar kinds of reactions, and picking up some of the same themes: imprisonment, transportation, redemption of convicts. But no, there is no direct connection, and it's absolutely infuriating because there could have been. In 1847, Charles Dickens visited Paris together with his permanent companion, Forster, and they wangled themselves an invitation to tea in Place des Vosges, you know, the home of the reigning genius of the day. And Dickens who was already translated into French. Oliver Twist and I think one other novel had appeared in French already. Of course, Dickens didn't have much of an education because of his ridiculous father. He spent his teenage years in putting boot black into pots. So he didn't have any Latin. Latin was Hugo's other language. I mean, Hugo was completely fluent in Latin. I mean, really fluent in a way that few people have been since. And Hugo was very disappointed that he couldn't talk to Dickens in Latin. And Dickens had not learnt French at school because he hadn't been to a proper school. But he had learnt some French in later on in life. So I imagine the conversation was just an exchange of pleasantries and formalities. There wasn't a common language. Hugo always refused to learn a word of English, even though he spent 19 years living on in the English-speaking world, but he wouldn't ever learn English. So there was not much they could say to each other. But, you know, just think of it. A very large part of the first three books of Les Misérables was already written and was there in that room on the shelf. And there was Dickens. And if only he'd sort of had proper Latin, they could have talked to each other about it. And who knows how different, you know, their career... Because there is such a lot... I think there's really a lot in common in the literary and moral sensitivities of the two men, that they do it differently, they have different place in life, etc. But there's really something profoundly Dickensian about Hugo and profoundly Hugoian about Dickens.
Okay, I think we've got time for one more question. Does anybody have something they'd like to ask? Okay, well, in that case, I would just ask one final one concerning your feeling about the man Victor Hugo himself, like in spending all this time with his work, finding out about his life, over the process of writing Novel of the Century, did your feelings towards him develop? Did you develop a certain affection for the man, a greater respect? Did you lose any respect for him? Was there sort of any kind of alteration in your opinions about Victor Hugo in this process?
A lot of writing about Victor Hugo is about Victor Hugo, the man, the statue, the megalomaniac, the self-inflate, etc. There's a lot that is mildly snide or sometimes actually hostile, because after all, he was Europe's greatest poet and Europe's greatest playwright and Europe's greatest novelist, and he lived a very long life and he had lots of women, and you know, it really get up your nose. I mean, but I really didn't want to, you know, really deal. I think I don't have a relationship with Victor Hugo. I try to deal with his life and his personality only insofar as it's part of the story of how Les Misérables came to be. The focus of my book is the book rather than the man. But actually, he was a great man. One of the things I admire about him most is that he did not ever stand still. Many people have criticized him for having changed his views on a whole load of issues, including political ones. I think that is a sign of great maturity, that he responded to changing circumstances, and he learned as he went along, and he never stopped learning. So I actually have a degree of admiration for that side of him.
Which is, I think, a perfect point to leave it on. I really can't recommend this book enough, and as I was seemingly in a similar position to most of you of not having read Les Misérables, as I was saying to David earlier, that I came out of reading the Novel of the Century with a real desire to pick up and read Les Misérables, which I can only say must be one of the many successes of the book. So we have plenty of copies at the till, as well as copies of his ear. Is that a fish in your ear? I'm sure David would be happy to sign them for you.
So as long as you buy them.
We are complete agreement on that. And so please just join me one more time in saying thank you to David Bellos.